Welcome. So today we're going to talk about statistical process control and how that relates to data gathering that we are previously doing when we're acquiring data. And this is typically when we're acquiring data from machine processes, manufacturing, could be other types of data as well that we want to have some type of feedback control system on. So let's kind of take a look a little bit about where, when things are out of control, where does this variation that we can measure comes from? So variation, unfortunately, is something that exists, and it's in all different types of system, all different type of processes, any types of measurements, even physical measurements. You're going to find variation, and there's a lot of variety of reasons for this, but what it comes down to, a common kind of noise is a noise from randomness, and there's all sorts of things that, depending upon what scale you're measuring, where these types of source of randomness can come from. They're usually not very easily to identify, hence why they're put in the random category. And a lot of times they're unavoidable. So there might be slight differences in a diameter, for example, or the weight of a certain unit of something, or time variations, temperature variations. So a lot of this comes from the fact that you always have certain uncertainty in anything you measure. And even down, you get down to the minute level of Brownian motion, there are things that you just can't do a whole lot about. And it's just part of the limits of the physical system you're dealing with. Now, that being said, there's sometimes variation that you can do something about, where you're starting to see variation that you can detect. And when you can detect certain kinds of variation that you can do something about, then it becomes a diagnostic of trying to figure out what is the cause of that variation, where is it coming from, what factors are contributing to it. And once you can identify those, these could be anything from a training issue. Maybe you have, you know, employees that are trained really well and you don't see that variation, but then another employee comes in, maybe they didn't have quite the right training, and so they're getting a variation in what they're doing. Could be a tool that's wearing out, a motor that's wearing out. Could be a machine that needs some repair. So all these types of things can add to a variation that once you detect it, then you can do something about it. And that's where statistical process control comes in. Now, basics that you have to know before you can get into statistical process control is the basics of statistics. So everybody should understand what a sample mean is, meaning instead of a mean of entire population, you take a sample, a random sample of a population, and you divide all those values in that random sampling divided by the number of samples, n, and you get something called x bar. So that is a sampled mean. The other things that are related to that is a range. So in those samplings, maybe we had a maximum measurement and we had a minimum measurement in that certain number of n samples. So we call that the range if we take the difference between those two. The other thing that's related to sampling is a sample standard deviation, which is different than the population total standard deviation. So typically, sigma represents by itself the total population standard deviation. However, a sampling, and some textbooks, they'll use sigma sub x bar or sigma sub x or s. It depends upon what type of reference you're using and what they're using. But essentially, in this equation here, s is actually equal to how we calculate the standard deviation. However, you lose a degree of freedom, so it's divided by n minus 1 underneath the radical instead of just n. And so that's a difference between the sample standard deviation. And that you're taking every point that you measure and subtracting it from the x bar that we calculated in the sample mean. So, and that's how you're getting those differences squared and then the square root. So that's the basics. So if we think about it in terms of how does data typically distributed, in a normal distribution, meaning most of our data is centered around the mean and it's equally roughly distributed, positive and negatively, we would see something like a normal distribution at the left. Now, whether or not it's high and narrow or wide and low tells us a little bit about the variance off of that mean. So the mean is the target, let's think about it that way, and how far from the target are all of our data points getting? Are they staying within a tight center, meaning they're more accurate, or are they spreading out all over the place, even though the average still works out to that? That means we're not very precise, and we're not very accurate. The other thing that can happen is you could start detecting a skewness, where symmetry, like on the ones on the left and in the red curve, that is a symmetrical curve, like a normal curve. However, if it skews, meaning you're going to have more data shifting on the high side or more data shifting on the low side, this is where we can see what that looks like. Now, it's a little opposite in terminology. So if you see it shifting to the right, we call that negative skewness. And if you see it shifting to the left, you call it positive skewness, even though from a positive-negative standpoint, it sounds like the opposite. So that becomes important because those are some of the patterns that we want to look for in the data. Now, when we start taking samplings of our process, our system, whatever it is, we want to then plot out. Let's say we take us every hour we take, five random samples or five measurements on a very key type of metric that we want to know whether we're in control or not. And so we do that every hour. Then we take the average of every one of those and then we plot a point. So that's what the point shown on here on this graph is. So we have this thing called the center line or the control line. This is where we're trying to actually target. That's kind of that mean or average. If you notice the way this plots, it's almost like taking the curve and putting it on its side that we were just looking at. And so variation gets shown in how high or low it is off of that center line versus the other way it would be left and right. Now, we also have control limits. We have an upper and a lower control limit, meaning that we're trying to target a certain number, but we want to see how far it goes up or down, but does it stay within those control limits? That's something that's very important to us because if we get outside of those control limits, maybe our widget won't perform or whatever it is that becomes a problem if it's not within those control limits. And if you notice here, they have a plot where a variable goes outside of the control limits, and so our system would be considered out of control, which is something we would want to prevent. And so all those certifications, when you go to green belt certification or black belt certification and all of those types of things, are all in the essence to be able to create systems that can stay within tight tolerance of the control limits that you set. And then how do you do that? How do you refine it, keep it to where it's tighter and tighter control? It increases efficiency if you do that. It also increases quality output and less waste. So there's all sorts of reasons why that is a valuable skill set to have. So, but let's kind of look and see, okay, well, what does this do and how do we plot these types of things? Well, first off, we have to figure out what kind of control limits do we want. We may have a target mean, and maybe that target is, 20 centimeter radius, or maybe we want something to weigh 5 pounds, or we want something to be 16 ounces. Whatever that target is, that's where the mean, where we want the mean to actually be. Now, is it perfect? No, but that's what we're trying to get to. When we try to think about the variable that we want to measure that gets us the best information on that, that tells us how well we can tightly control this process. And another way to look at it is, what is an acceptable failure rate? So if something doesn't work out, what is an acceptable failure rate? Is it 1 in 100 failures? That might be acceptable for like in egg batches, but that might not be acceptable for something that's more like critical. Or is it 1 in 1,000,000? That could be something completely different. And then the other thing you have to consider is what percentage of type 1 error is acceptable. So a type 1 error is where we're on the outskirts, but it's giving us a false positive. So this is where we have what we call alpha. And it's really outside of the standard deviations that are acceptable to us. What is that remainder on each of the two tails? So that could be as acceptable 5%, which is common if you have a 95% that you want within the control limits, like we see on the left. It's roughly 95.44% at 2 sigma, between negative and positive 2 sigma. Or do we want something more like 99.74%, which on this curve represents plus or minus 3 sigma? That would give us much more confidence in our numbers. Or do we go out to 6 sigma, which oftentimes is a goal for black belts? which is where you get to that one in a million types of failures. So that's the kind of thing that you want to be considering when you decide what are appropriate control limits. It's application specific, it's risk specific. Are we talking about something that is an implanted defibrillator? You don't want 100 of those going bad. That's going to be a major problem for you. Or are we talking about like a fidget spinner, you know, where it's not a big deal if something fails? So those are the kinds of things you have to think about when you're setting those control limits. So in SQC, there are actually three main chart types. We're actually only going to go into the XBAR R charts in this particular class. And another class, I go into a whole bunch of other charts. But this is the one that specifically we're going to be doing, particularly in our sprint with XBAR R charts. And an XBAR R chart is where you have a target, just like what we've been talking about, that mean that we want to have right on target. And we have a range of acceptability off from that mean. So we're going to, that's why it's the XBAR R chart, because we have the mean and the range charts. Two other types of charts, just for clarification, is a portion chart or P chart. And this is where you're trying to inspect the portion of failures in an inspection group. So let's say you randomly pick 12 units to inspect every time. Three out of those 12 fail. That's not a great turnout. That's about 25% failure rate, but it's basically a portion of a total that you're measuring. So that's a little bit different. The other type is a count or a C chart. And this is where you're counting flaws on a single unit. So maybe this is a garment and you're looking for how many flaws are on there, or, you know, the next Nike tennis shoe and you're looking for glue lines or things that are off. And so you can count those flaws. So that's probably the most simplest form. But for now, we're not going to go into those. We're going to go into the XBAR R charts for the rest of this discussion. So when it comes to an X chart, again, we're actually plotting the means of all of our random samplings. And what we're looking for on an X chart is, again, a point that is going out of bounds. Like in the first upper left in A, it shows a point that's going out of bounds below the lower control limit on the left-hand side. Ideally, what we'd like to see, where we have things in control, is the points on the X chart equally balanced above and below that center line, and not contacting or going over either of those control lines. And so that tells us, as you see the two different curves, whether we have a tighter control or a looser control. And so it gives us that essence. It also tells us if we're shifting off from the mean. We might be able to detect that. Another way to detect that is on the range, where we can detect shifts from mean a lot easier. So in this case, we could have lots of data points on the range that may be looking like we have a little bit more in one direction or another, so our effective mean is actually shifting a bit. The other thing, the R chart, we also want to make sure it's within control limits so that we don't go outside of those boundaries. All right. So again, just to sum up, why do we use an XBAR chart? It's so we can monitor changes in the mean of a process, that central tendency. And this can show us an acceptable variability, but unacceptable central tendencies. An R chart monitors the variability of the process, so it can show us acceptable central tendencies, but unacceptable variability. In other words, maybe the system's getting too variable, too wide. So let's look at an example. So here in this case, we have sampled our process three different times at three different random time points, and we took four observations each one of those times. So to get the first thing we calculate for each of those samples, and remember, sampling is a collection of observations in this case, is we take the average of those four samples. So you can see that X bar is really taking the average of observations 1 through 4 in all those three cases. The ranges then finds the maximum number and the minimum number and subtracts the two. And that's how you get those three sample ranges. The center line then is calculated from all those averages. So notice we have our observations, but our sample means, the averages which are right below those arrows, not the ones they're pointing at. We actually had three separate samplings. So that's our K. That's how many times we did a mean sampling. And then so we would add up all those means, the 15.875, 15.975, 15.9, etc., and then divide that by k. So it's really an average of averages, if you think about it, which is why you can call it x bar bar, which kind of leads to bar bar jokes, but we'll not go there. Now, when we're trying to figure out the upper control limit and the lower control limit, ideally, if you had the standard deviation of the full population, you could calculate that directly. And that would be sigma divided by the square root of n, which would then give you the sample standard deviation. Sometimes you might know that or have a good approximation to be confident in it. Sometimes you don't. If you don't, then you actually have to use a little bit different technique to figure out what to add and subtract by to get your upper control limits. And it actually uses the z value to do that. Okay, so let's say, for example, we know that, and then we know the population standard deviation of error, and it's, in this case, 0.2, and then we had our n, which was 4 observations, so it's divided by square root of 4. And so in the control limit calculations, you can see the 0.2 divided by square root of 4, and that's multiplied by the z value. Now, the z value is a chosen value based upon what type of control limit do we want. Is it 3 sigma? So in this case, sigma is anonymous with z because we have plus or minus 3 sigma, which gives us roughly, in this case, 99.7% confidence. And then if you notice, it's added and subtracted to the mean that we got. And so that's essentially how we calculate that upper and lower control limit. Once we have these three lines, because that's what they are, they're plotted as lines, we can then plot our data against these lines. And so that's what you would do in Excel. And in class, we'll talk about how to do that. So you have your center line at 15.92, you have your upper limit at 16.22, and your lower control limit line at 15.62. Now, not everybody has the entire standard deviation for the population. If you don't really know it, or you don't have enough data to estimate it with relevant accuracy, then you can use some process tables that have been developed over the years using what they call the A2 factor. Now, there is one in a reference, but in the factor table, which I think I've got it over here, in this table, you look up the number of observations in every sample. And there are several variables that you can pick out. The A2 is the one for the X chart, and there's a D3, D4. Now, this constant table isn't just in textbooks. It's actually, you can find these accurate tables online as well. You just have to look for X chart, R chart, constant tables. And you can find those values for any n that you're interested in. So it turns out for this particular case, when we had n equals a 4, the A2 value was 0.73. And so we use that to multiply times the actual range. So if you notice here, we're still calculating the upper control limit and the lower control limit on the X bar chart. Make sure that you understand this is still on the X bar chart. It just so happens that if we know the range for each of those cases, which we do, we calculated it as 0.233, it becomes that value of A2 times the average of the range for all those samplings. And so that's a different way to estimate an upper bound and lower bound. And so it's slightly different. It's 16.09 here and 15.75. But that's another way to get relatively good control lines, upper and control limits, without knowing the entire population standard deviation. And once you plot that, then the center line, typically they make the center line, you know, a different looking line. In this one, they made it a thick solid line. And then you have your upper control limit and your lower control limit. Here they made it in dashed lines. And then you plot then the actual sample means that you got each and every time you took those samples. And remember, each one of these points represents an average of, in this case, four observations. So And if you look at this, it looks relatively in control because it's kind of equally balanced above and below the control line, and nothing seems to be deviating toward any of the limits. So that's kind of information you're going to get out of your X-bar chart. So we would think this is pretty on target with keeping the mean, and the mean's not slipping too far off from our target. Now, for the range chart, again, because this is going to tell us about variability, we've already calculated the range. We're just showing it again here, the average range. And then here's where we use the other components of the table, D4 and D3. And again, remember, it's tied to the number of observations in each sample, in each random sampling that you do. And because we're using 4, our D3 is a value of 0, our D4 is 2.28. So we plug those in for D4 and D3, and then we multiply those by R. Now notice we don't have a mean to go from, it's just above and below. We have our control limits here. Our control limit here is the actual range that we actually see. So it's kind of the mean of our ranges, if you think about it that way. So that becomes our control line. And so now we plot these three lines. Now I should note as well, notice here we had a value of 0, and ultimately our lower control limit is at 0, which actually makes sense. You can't really go negative, even if you wanted to, because if your range gets to 0, that means you're not deviating at all from the original range, which would probably be about as good as it gets, right? So keeping it on the range is about as nice as it gets. Okay, so if you notice that the data points again are equally balanced above and below, and we're within our control limits. So again, this would show that our system is in control. Now, when we go and do this in class, you're going to be collecting your own data, and we're going to have data that simulates in-control data versus out-of-control data, and we want to be able to see both the calculations and these plots in your Excel spreadsheets. So hope you enjoyed this video, and I'll see you in class. Take care.